We are back for part two of the spine. When things go bad, and how to prevent it from happening in the first place. If you missed the first part of the spine series, it is meant to be a broad look at how the spine is supposed to work. This video is meant to discuss injuries and prevention of those injuries. These are issues that many athletes of all levels have to deal with. Current and former UFC champions are no exception. I'm Dr. Lucius Pomerantz, board-certified orthopedic surgeon, black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, with the goal to be a free source of information on how our bodies move and how to reduce confusion and anxiety about our injuries in the context of combat sports. So, injuries to our back. Back injuries are one of the most common injuries out there. Back pain is one of the top reasons for people to visit a doctor. There are many potential causes. There are stories of sneezing causing injury. This would make sense, as you may recall from part one, where the spine can influence the pressures of our abdomen. And, well, the opposite is true too. Of course, some of us have heard of the very rare complication of a vertebral artery dissection from a chiropractor's treatment, or from one's own manipulation, or in combat sports. For the sake of combat sports, I will focus in on two major sources of pain: direct trauma and degenerative conditions, also known as wear and tear. Trauma to the spine. Trauma can take the form of more simple injuries, such as strains of the musculature or sprains of the ligaments. When the forces on the muscles, ligaments, and or tendons exceed what they can handle, they tear. This causes pain, cramping, and can be quite disabling. Our backs are very important to our ability to just walk upright. But we all worry about the bad injuries, like fractures of the vertebrae, dislocations of the joints, or herniations of the vertebral discs. The position of the body when the trauma occurs greatly influences what things become damaged. A purely axial load or a compressive load, like a tackle leading with the head, might cause a very different injury than when things are getting twisted. Of course, many injuries are a combination of things. All of these will cause pain due to the injury of tissues, but what is most concerning is the potential injury of the spinal cord, exiting nerve roots, and or vertebral arteries. If there's ever concern for significant neck or back injury, doctors will take the highest precautions until it is assured those injuries are not present or they're treated properly. The cervical spine, our necks, it's the least protected part of our back. There's just less stuff supporting the cervical spine than the thoracic or lumbar spine. Smaller muscles, no ribs, combined with greater degree of freedom of movement, contribute to the cervical spine being injured. Also, the cervical spine is more exposed and more easily levered around with manipulation of the head, which is often the target of attacks. The thoracic spine is the most protected and therefore less frequently injured in sports. The lumbar spine must support the most weight and forces going through it as someone lifts or moves upright. These forces may exceed 10 times our body weight. Specific types of injuries will include many things. First, the disc herniation. It's a common injury. Sometimes the outer layer of our discs just breaks down. Sometimes trauma creates a tear, but either way, the cushiony substance within the disc, we talked about this in part one, is pushed out, and depending on the location, it can push on the spinal cord itself and or the exiting nerve roots. When nerves are being affected, there will be pain, there will be numbness, and there will be weakness to muscles. If it is just an exiting nerve root, the pain, numbness is often fairly localized. In fact, there are dermatome maps of the skin that show which specific nerves innervate particular areas. The affected muscles will be limited or could even be paralyzed. Recently crowned UFC bantamweight champion Aljo Sterling had a disc that pinched his left 7th cervical nerve root, resulting in weakness in his left tricep. It was so bad he required surgery.
So this is a view like this, where you're laying flat on your back, your face up, and we're looking from your feet up. So this is the left and this is the right, and it slices like this. So this is the disc in the front. This is the left side. See the L for left, and this is the right.
Yep.
Because we're looking from your feet up. This is the disc in the front. This is the back. This is the bone you feel in the back of your neck. This is your spinal cord, this black tube right here.
Yes.
And this white is the holes where the nerves come out. So this disc is C6, C7. So this is the right side. And see that white tube right there? It's open.
Nice.
That's normal. Look at the left.
Yeah.
See how pinched that is? How big is this white space compared to this space? You know, it's like 10% compared to that.
Yeah.
When he came back from the surgery, he appeared to do much better in his rematch with Peter Yan. If the spinal cord is injured, then everything below that level will be affected. Another common injury issue, often affecting the lower back, is a condition called spondylolysis. It is more common in younger athletes. It is often blamed on sports with repetitive hyperextension and axial loading of the spine, which includes gymnastics, rugby, wrestling, football. You get the point. These forces cause a portion of the lumbar vertebrae to break. Fortunately, with early recognition and proper treatment, this will heal on its own fairly quickly and without surgery. Other fractures or dislocations can push bone or the nerves, spinal cord, or from the cervical spine, vertebral arteries are located, and they may get pinched or even severed. If a vertebral artery is injured, there can be bleeding, decreased blood flow to the brain. Sometimes the vessels clot off and cause a stroke. Bad times. Symptoms could include headache, neck pain, vision changes, difficulty speaking, and/or issues with using one side of the body. Fortunately, these catastrophic injuries are rare. Most of what athletes and the general population have to deal with is muscle strains. As mentioned before, these muscles work hard to support the spine, but sometimes circumstances force them beyond what they can handle. The muscles can tear, or the tendons can tear. This hurts. There may also be muscle cramping and limited range of motion. There may be difficulty in getting upright and moving around, but there should not be weakness into the arms or legs, or any numbness. Degenerative issues. Wear and tear, our bodies inevitably break down. Our genetics, activity level, and trauma history all contribute to the speed in which things break down. This means that arthritis can develop within the vertebral joints or between the vertebral bodies themselves as vertebral discs lose their height and ability to cushion impact. Sometimes the arthritic tissue can expand into the spinal canal or into where these nerve roots travel, causing similar symptoms as to what we've already talked about with disc herniations. Of course, when there is severe arthritis and the bones of the joints are grinding on themselves, this causes inflammation and pain as well. Pain may also develop from muscle imbalances that develop as a way of compensating for injury or breakdown. Sometimes it can be very hard to figure out what exactly is going on, even for the doctors involved. Sometimes imaging beyond simple x-rays is required. This includes CT scans, which are like super x-rays that give three-dimensional views, or MRIs that help us see the soft tissues like nerve or disc or ligament. Now, very important, prevention. As the saying goes, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, or something like that. There are definitely things you can do to prevent back injury and pain. These apply to whether you want to avoid an injury or take pressure off a chronic issue. First, strengthen your core. As mentioned multiple times, the muscles around our spine play a huge role in supporting our spine. This means not only strengthening the actual back muscles, but also strengthening your abdominal muscles and core muscles around the pelvis. I do want to point out this is more than just sit-ups. It means whole body exercises that force you to contract the correct muscles. You also need to have good balance and strength within the muscles that attach to the pelvis, including your hamstrings, quads, to prevent issues with the lower back. I also want to point out neck positioning and strength. As mentioned before, our necks are particularly susceptible to injury, especially in combat sports, as our head is used as a lever during throws, chokes, and other submissions, and the head is a target in striking. One thing that can help avoid injury is keeping your eyes up and chin down. One, by seeing what is coming, you take proper precautions. Two, as any wrestler has been told when shooting a double leg, you tend to go where you are looking. By having your eyes down, your neck will flex, it'll be weaker, and more exposed to attack. It should make sense now how muscle strength around the neck can help prevent neck injury. However, theoretically, strength around the neck can even help reduce concussive blows on the brain. You heard that right. A strong neck could help prevent concussions. This is done by, theoretically, the strong neck muscles reducing the acceleration and deceleration that the brain sees from a strike. Not getting hit is the best prevention. Next, you must have balanced musculature. Disproportionately working out a particular body part because that is the exercise you want to be better at, or the body part you want to look better, may neglect important muscle groups and set you up for back pain. Guys doing lots of bench press but not enough pulling are an example. Also, those of you who do only one sport can get imbalanced and may need to really focus on muscles that otherwise do not get attention. This is a long way of saying that cross-training is a good thing. Over any month, I will have used kettlebells, steel maces, parabol, rowing machine, jogged, swam, and kept doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Knowing how to lift things is probably the first thing that you can institute right away. Having your back straight, lifting with your legs, keep the weight close to your body, are all important things to do. The amount of force that goes through your spine is drastically increased with bad form. If you have a hunched back, do not get your legs involved, and have the weight far from your body, then you are putting extra stress through your back that it probably does not need to see. Sometimes this means that you have to be disciplined all the way through the exercise, including when you're putting the weights down. Lastly, tap early in training. Many of us want to fight through things. This could be the submission we're trapped in, or still pushing through a workout when we are hitting muscle failure or already have an injury. These things could result in causing a problem or making it worse. Obviously, you all probably are not going to stop doing the things you like, but sometimes that means modifying what you are doing. Sometimes it's tapping out earlier. Sometimes it's avoiding certain situations. Hopefully, you all want to do this stuff for a long time. Take care of yourself and let your ego rest. I much rather deal with tapping to a guillotine choke than having a tweaked neck while operating. So, get after it. Have fun. Be good to your body, and it will be good to you. Let's keep moving.